Who is in charge of the cleanup? For 4 days, we've been trying to get an answer to one question. How much total shoreline has been impacted by the oil since the spill started? But the united command of the government and BP has steadfastly refused to answer our question. All they will say is that as of tonight, 52 miles of shoreline are currently impacted. And add to that the complaint from the Gulf that cleanup efforts are disorganized 59 days into the spill. Once again, we want to show you the organization chart showing the labyrinth of agencies involved in decision making. And David Muir was with two frustrated governors today. David?
So frustrated, Diane. I'm standing on one of those giant barges tonight with the tanks meant to be vacuuming up the oil. It should be out well into the Gulf doing its work tonight, but on day 59, trying to figure out why it's still docked here and who's in charge was, well, exasperating.
Case in point, Buras, Louisiana, where for the last 24 hours, those barges carrying giant vacuums sat here under orders not to move.
All 16 of these barges have been halted.
It's the most frustrating thing.
Louisiana's governor told us he wasn't told why.
The president has said you can pick up the phone and call him. Did you tell him this? Did you call him?
We talked to the White House yesterday. They promised us they were going to get it done as quickly as possible. And the problem is that every time you talk to somebody different than the Coast Guard, you got a different answer.
Jindal says at one point the Coast Guard said it couldn't find the people who put those barges together.
So who's in charge here?
Well, the Coast Guard's the one that stopped them from going to work.
But as governor of this state, can't you say, stay out there, stay working?
Coast Guard came and shut them down.
And then today, while we were there, word from the Coast Guard saying, go ahead.
If you look behind me, you can see the first of the barges now heading back out into the Gulf after learning they can actually use them again. 16 of them have been sitting here, these vacuums all hooked up, ready to go. The governor says they could have been collecting oil.
And this sort of confusion is still everywhere. In Alabama today, Governor Bob Riley told us he asked the Coast Guard to find ocean boom tall enough to handle ocean waves. They went all the way to Bahrain to find it. And when it came time to deploy it here,
it was picked up and moved to Louisiana.
Without it, oil came ashore in Alabama.
Who's in charge here?
Great question.
The governor says there is still no one person saying yes or no. He says governors come up with their plans working with the Coast Guard, but then he says all of those federal agencies start weighing in. Fish and Wildlife, EPA, OSHA, all with veto power. While back in Louisiana tonight, a frustrated Governor Jindal too, doing the math.
Remember when you and I last visited one of these? He said during our visit, they sucked up over 4,000 gallons.
During that visit, David, so how much oil could have been collected if there hadn't been that delay?
Yeah, incredible. 4,000 gallons, he said, and we were only out there for about an hour last week with that vacuum. So in 24 hours, this one barge could have picked up 96,000 gallons of oil. People laughed at these vacuums, but they've been making a real difference. This one's got to get out there tonight.
And again, two governors now saying they cannot get straight answers. Thank you, David Muir.
This is sheer incompetency on behalf of the federal government. The nature of bureaucracy is that it is so complex and confusing that it causes nothing but problems. And for some reason, the governors don't use their 10th Amendment powers to kick out the federal agencies and clean up the beaches and shorelines themselves, regardless of the consequences of the federal government. This leads to the question of why is this going on? From the time of making this film, it has been over 70 days since the oil spill. The Jones Act is still in effect, states are still being stonewalled, and President Obama has yet to allow international ships on the U.S. shores. When he finally does, it will be too little, too late. The disgusting truth is that the federal government, Goldman Sachs, and BP want this disaster. They are using this environmental catastrophe to push through their political agenda. All three entities are in strong support of the cap and trade bill. Goldman Sachs at the top of the pyramid in the carbon trading scheme, as author Stephen Malloy points out. He takes into account the following. The current chairman of the Commodity Future Trading Commission is Gary Gensler, formerly of Goldman Sachs. Goldman Sachs is a part owner of the exchanges where carbon allowances will be traded. Goldman Sachs has spent millions of dollars lobbying for cap-and-trade legislation in anticipation of making billions of dollars at the expense of taxpayers and consumers. Goldman has a special exemption from the CFTC to exceed the trading limits normally placed on commodity speculators. Not only was this exemption secret for 17 years, the CFTC recently had to ask Goldman for permission to release the letter to Congress. Goldman Sachs employees are heavy contributors to the Democratic Party, giving it over $4.4 million in the last election. Barack Obama received more than $997,000. We all know that President Obama is in favor of cap and trade. His speech to the nation following this disaster was 17 minutes long, and the last 7 minutes were dedicated entirely to trying to convince America to embrace a clean energy future. In other words, cap and trade. Here are just a few clips of President Obama's address trying desperately to convince the public to accept cap and trade.
The tragedy unfolding on our coast is the most painful and powerful reminder yet that the time to embrace a clean energy future is now. Last year, the House of Representatives acted on these principles by passing a strong and comprehensive energy and climate bill, a bill that finally makes clean energy the profitable kind of energy for America's businesses. Now, there are costs associated with this transition, and there's some who believe that we can't afford those costs right now. I say we can't afford not to change how we produce and use energy.
And finally, as the Washington Examiner pointed out, BP was a founding member of the U.S. Climate Action Partnership, a lobby dedicated to passing the cap and trade bill, mainly because BP is the nation's largest producer of natural gas, and the cap and trade bill would eventually force coal to be switched over to natural gas. It is important to mention that the headline of this article is entirely misconstrued. To call BP a capitalist pet is preposterous at best, because America is not a capitalist country. A capitalist country is made up of businesses free from government intervention and overregulation, and with the government free from corporate payoffs and bribes. In a free market capitalist society, this oil rig explosion never would have happened, as pointed out by Judge Andrew Napolitano, because those with money at stake would have been making decisions rather than politicians.
With us now, senior judicial analyst Judge Andrew Napolitano.
We have all grown too accustomed to relying on the federal government to make so many decisions that in years past were made by private industry where their own money was at risk. So the government doesn't lose anything if it bungles this. The oil companies have no choice, Shep, but to rely on what the government tells them. The permitting process is not like getting a permit to build an addition on your house. It takes years to comply with. And in order to comply with it, you have to show that you recognize the government's statistics and you comply with them. So if the government makes a mistake and you rely on it, you make a mistake. The government relied in 2008 and 2009 on computer models that were created in 2004, and those computer models were either outdated or erroneous. So on the basis of this erroneous information, the government says, don't dig in 500 feet where Governor Jindal says you can dig, where you want to dig, where we know you can easily control a spill. Dig in 5,000 feet where our environmentalist folks think you should dig.
I'm getting kind of grossed out, Judge. You blaming the government for this?
I'm blaming the government for this.
Judge.
I'm not blaming the government
for this. BP had more safety violations than all of the other oil companies in the country combined times 10. They cut corners at every. They cut corners everywhere. The nightmare well. The list of BP is this long. And then they stand in front of us, call us litigious, and act as if we've done something bad, that horrible man. And now you're going to turn around and blame the government for these bumbling, fumbling, crazy people?